This is the Corsair One. And even though I'm usually more, shall we say, into custom-built systems, pre-built or not, this is an impressively stout piece of kit given its size, cooling, and noise level. So much so that it's something that I've always wanted to replicate with a custom-built PC. And today might be the day. Behind me is the Loc RAW S1. It's not exactly a Corsair One. For instance, it relies on air cooling rather than AIO liquid coolers. And it's actually just a case that you can fill with whatever hardware you want. Ah, there it is. Ooh! But it's apparently got the kahunas to fit full fat, top of the line gear. And today we're gonna do pretty much exactly that. 5900X, 3080. This tiny package. And it's brought to you by iFixit. Whether you're new to repairing your devices or you're in the industry, iFixit wants to make it easier for you to keep your devices working. So stay tuned at the end of the video to learn more about iFixit's toolkits. I am really excited to see this. Honestly, for how good the Corsair One looks and for how well it works, I'm surprised it's taken this long for someone to make a Corsair One alike. Now, how close did they get in terms of the size though? Because that's what Corsair did that's pretty freaking magic. Wow. Darn close. Almost as though their engineers set out with the target of building something the size of the Corsair One. Whatever resemblance they bear to each other externally though, these are very different products, make no mistake. The Corsair One, even though Corsair is a case manufacturer, is not available as a case. And a big part of the reason for that is that it is not very user-friendly to build in. So even though Loki, I've been told it's pronounced, did go and build something that obviously achieves a very similar form factor, whether or not they managed to make it user-friendly is an entirely separate matter. I will say this much, it definitely doesn't have the fit and finish of the Corsair One, but the Corsair One's also really expensive. Also doesn't have the I/O of the Corsair One. You got your front USB 3, you got your front HDMI for that VR revolution that's definitely about to happen. be nice, David. Whereas on the Loki, there's just a power button in the front, and then you've got two USB Type-Cs, only one of which is actually connected to anything, and they're at the back. Wait a minute. Where the hell is my motherboard? Oh, it's one of those, it's on the bottom. That worked great, iFixit being the sponsor today, and Loki making a case that you need a Torx to open. Thank you for that. In fairness, Loki does include this so that you can open the Torx screws, but like, it would be better to just have a Phillips head like every other computer case on the face of the planet. So it's $329, but it comes with a Gen 4 riser, which means you can run your Gen 4 graphics card at full speed, which is anywhere from a $60 to a $90 value. So it's still pretty expensive, but these small run, small form factor cases are often priced higher than you might think. This is pretty cool. The reason you've got these clips here is that this is actually a modular I/O system. You could also replace your power button. I mean, at least if something broke, you can replace it.
Like as long as the power button isn't like glued into the case, I'm happy.
All right. Got a nice orange accent. Are you guys sucking up? Jokes about infinite FPS aside, this thing is freaking sweet. So it uses a high temp extruded jacket with a twin axe shielding, silver plated solid copper conductors inside that as a complete package can apparently exceed the PCI Express Gen 4 spec, never mind meet it. I like the high temp resistance because we're gonna put an RTX 3080 in here, so gonna need that. Nice and low profile too, that's really nice. Enough about that though, let's meet the rest of our components, starting with the ROG Strix X570i Gaming. Now, this isn't technically speaking the flagship small form factor board in ASUS's lineup for Socket AM4, but the reason we went with it is that the Crosshair 8 Impact is actually DTX, or like a longer version of ITX. So it's about this much longer, which in a case like this, as you can plainly see, would not freaking fit. Of course, being an enthusiast board with an 8+2 phase, not to mention surprisingly well-cooled power delivery, and support for PCI Express Gen 4, we wanted to take full advantage of that with an AMD Ryzen 9 5900X. 12 freaking cores, 24 freaking threads, basically the best performance for gaming on the market, and assuming you can get one at MSRP, it's more than $100 cheaper than Intel's 12-core 10920X. But then again, Intel has yet to release an 11th Gen Extreme Edition. Are they even gonna bother at this point?
I don't know.
I don't know. It's a little awkward. For RAM, we've gone with a relatively unusual choice for us. A lot of the time we like to go, you know, RGB blinged out all over the place, but instead, we've gone with Corsair's LPX 3600 MHz CL16 in a 2x16 gig configuration. And the reason for that is the LP in LPX stands for low profile. This way we get all the speed that we need without compromising on clearance for our CPU cooler. This is the NHL 12S. This is Noctua's solution for people who need a slim cooler that can fit in a really low profile case, but still want that big chungus cooling performance. So it uses a slim version of their popular NFA series fan. And then this is interesting. By default, it actually comes with the fan configured to take air from around the CPU socket and blow it up, which on many of these types of cases is typically intended to be used as an exhaust. But for us, we're actually going to turn it around so it'll act as an intake for the case. But not yet. First, we actually need to remove a couple of pieces of the motherboard. It's all minor stuff, just this little cosmetic fascia piece right here. And that should be good enough. Now, unfortunately, Loki didn't release it in time for us to request parts for this video, but fortunately for you, they actually did a grand CPU cooler test for this case, and it turns out the Noctua L12 Ghost S1 edition, which is actually made for one of their other cases, is the best cooler for this case as well. And the main difference with that one is that it's a little bit shorter and then uses a 92 millimeter on the bottom, and then you can add a slim 120 millimeters to the top, so you get that push-pull action. But this one is still pretty darn good, so we're not too worried about it.
Let's get some thermal compound on here.
So is your new place's backyard big?
Oh, hold on, we're video making. Just a sec.
We're just like chit-chatting here. I bought a new place, so Jake's like, hey, you know, when COVID's done, we could all have like a backyard barbecue there. And yes, I'm super down. We could totally do that for our Christmas party. We haven't had our Christmas party yet.
Yeah, we might be able to do it in like August.
It'll be my birthday Christmas party.
What are you, turning 42?
Let's get our fan in here. There we go. Now, you might be wondering, well, gee, Linus, if it performs better if you have another slim on the top, why don't you just do that? Okay, we thought of that. Unfortunately, because of how low profile the case is, you can't fit another one. Now let's throw in our SSD. Just like the rest of the system, we've gone PCI Express Gen 4 here with Sabrent's Rocket 4 Plus. Wait a minute, this isn't the QLC one, is it? No, this is the like baller fast one.
Yeah, that's the one that has the new controller.
Though. Oh, sick! It's fully capable of saturating a Gen 4 link, and because it uses high quality NAND and a newer controller, it's gonna perform well in basically any situation. Wow, I didn't even notice the second fan down here for the chipset. What the hell? I love it. Yeah, it's a super cool board.
A weird motherboard screws. They're like super long, even though the standoffs are kind of a normal length, but.
But they go deep.
Yeah, it works fine, and that's it. Like, that's how much space you got, ladies and gentlemen. It's freaking tight. Of course, since Corsair makes basically everything, even when you don't buy their system, they still find a way to get you. We're using a Corsair SF750 power supply. It's 80 plus platinum certified, it's fully modular, it's super small. It's 750 watts, did I mention that already? We're gonna go ahead and pop this bad boy right about, yeah. Jake informs me that I put the power supply in too early because my exhaust fan goes here and that I will have to take the power supply out in order to install it. I reject his reality and I substitute my own, so I'm going to take this bracket off and try to mount the fan and put it back in. I gotta have fun. You build enough computers, you gotta find your own, you know, new challenges. Yeah, this puppy can probably go back here. Oh, I like that, actually. So the way the power supply is mounted, it goes right up against the side, which means it's a little easier for it to grab that nice fresh air. And it gives you some space behind the power supply to stash these cables. The bad news is I'm gonna have a real hard time accessing the front panel connectors, you know, for the power switch, power LED, hard drive LED reset switch.
The good news is there's only a power switch. There's literally not even a power LED on the case. So let's go ahead and see if we can get this in here. Just gotta kinda give it a little bendy bend and then...
I just realized, I was thinking, where's the front panel USB 3, right? Like we have a front panel connector. No. This cable just plugs into the back of your motherboard if you have a Type-C and then it's a pass-through. That's not amazing. Now let's find out if I can install this fan on this thing and then somehow it feels like one of those like brain teaser things. Wait, which goes Jesus on Christ. This way?
Is it set up as an exhaust? Did you do that for properly?
I don't know, are you exhausted yet?
No. I can handle a little more.
Wait, crap, did I put this on the right way? Yeah, I did.
Okay, Jesus.
Not bad, eh?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Graphics card time?
Sure.
As for why we went with an RTX 3080 TUF from ASUS, Loki has a list of cards that fit. This 3080 and actually the TUF 3090 fit. Oh, I'm sorry, did you want more of a story there? If it fits, it sits? Is that good enough? Okay, but in all seriousness, the reason we went 3080 was because we were trying to match the spec of the Corsair One that actually was just released with Ryzen 5th Gen and an RTX 3080 as the top spec. You know what's kind of crazy about this thing? While the build quality is just not up to par with the Corsair One, the ease of use? Great. This was such an easy build for a small form factor.
Right?
Yeah. I love it. They did just a bang up job of it. I mean, even this weird little like thumb nut thing down here that I was trying to figure out earlier. I was like, oh, what the heck is this thing for? Check this out. So you just slide the card into the PCI Express slot, and there it goes. Tighten this down. Boom, your card's sort of held in place. That's awesome. All right.
I shit my pants walking home one time.
I'm just gonna go ahead and plug this in. We've gotten a little off topic here. We gotta turn on the power supply now because once the case is slid over here, we're not gonna have access to that button anymore. And that's it. That's the computer.
That's dense.
Look at this. This feels like a sci-fi movie or some crap. It's like, you gotta pull it out and you gotta and put it in this way and then. Of course, we gotta take a look at the thermals before we declare this thing a victory here, because while the case does have a pretty similar amount of speed holes compared to the Corsair One, it kinda seems like there's more aluminum left. And it's air-cooled, so let's give it a shot here. So I guess it goes in this way, because that's the power button there.
Yep, and there's like rails that slides in.
Oh wow, I nailed that.
And then just be careful of the riser as it comes
Linus.
Down.
Wow, it's not just easy to build, it's easy to build without it being just like impossible to have the cables sticking into the fans
power
and stuff.
Oh my god.
Oh, is the power button a little, okay. So there are some quality of life improvements they could make, I guess.
It just rested the weight of the entire computer on the power button.
Yeah, and look how well it, oh no, it's good, I think it's good. Okay, so we'll plug that in there. So here, I'm showing you the ingenious front I/O system. Get the,
try the other side.
Thing in there. Okay, we're good. There's our super good ease of use front I/O access. There you go, I mean, doesn't look bad from the back. We've seen cases like this before. I mean, back Silverstone's first Raven had the motherboard rotated 90 degrees and you plugged everything in on the top and it went down a thing and out the back. So, I mean, it's all right. I think the color could be a little bit better in terms of, you know, look on the desk compared to the Corsair One, but full marks ease of use. If we hadn't just been like bullshitting around for the last 3 hours, we could have been done this in, I don't know, what, 45 minutes?
Yeah.
Like, it's a pretty easy build.
If you had everything mounted to the motherboard, you would be done in like 5 minutes if you really tried.
I can't tell if it's on or not yet.
Did you break it or something?
Let me just tilt this down on my, you know, nice soft place to rest at lttstore.com.
Suffocate the GPU a little bit.
Huh. Oh, there's your problem.
I know how to build a computer.
This isn't building a computer. This is plugging in the display connector to a computer. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. 32 gigs RAM, CPU's picked up, SSD's picked up, great news. Let's just go ahead and set the DOCP, 3600 megahertz. Firing up our game now, one key difference between the low-key RAW S1 and the Corsair one that we're kind of sort of comparing it to is the airflow path. So with the Corsair, you're drawing everything in, these two radiators on the side, okay? And then it all goes up the top, kind of probably maybe inspired by the Trash Can Mac Pro. With the RAW S1, it's a totally different airflow path because the top is actually mostly enclosed. So you've got these open sides. So your graphics card pulls in this nice fresh air from outside, mostly, because it's kind of kicking that hot air around inside and it's going to intermingle a little bit. And then over on the other side, we're using our CPU and our power supply as an intake. And then we've got this single Noctua fan exhausting out the back. So I'm expecting a lot of heat to come out here. And that could be a bit of a cooling bottleneck for us.
Is it getting louder?
It's not bad at all, actually. Oh, I suck.
Change that.
Insufficient fuel? Wait, what just happened?
You might have to wait a little bit. It recharges.
Oh, does it? There we go.
Yeah, change out the first one.
Coach David! Coach David's helping me out.
I'm on fire.
Oh, I thought I got it.
We'll make a...
Curse you. Oh, no, I'm in trouble now. Come on.
Nice.
We are maxed out at 78 degrees, 79, just over 80 on our hottest CCD. CPU reported temperatures are just over 80. That is extremely respectable for a game that runs at such a high FPS like Doom Eternal. As for our GPU, wow, not bad. 87 tops for our hotspot. That's super respectable. Memory up around 90. Dang.
Damn.
It's not even crazy loud. Ooh, it's warm though. Wow, that exhaust is, as anticipated, pretty toasty. But other than the kind of green color, I think I'd love to see some different editions of this case and different finishes and different colors. I think this thing's a win. So easy to build though.
Yeah.
Like, nothing else quite like it. So great job, Loki. And great job, me, for telling you about our sponsor. Thanks, iFixit, for sponsoring today's video. iFixit wants to help you repair or upgrade everything from your phone to your home appliances. Their ProTech toolkit has 64 steel bits and the popular steel blade jimmy for precise prying, and also includes other commonly used tools like suction cups, driver extensions, an anti-static wrist strap, and more. Everything is covered by iFixit's lifetime warranty, so why wait? Save time and money by repairing your own electronics using one of iFixit's over 70,000 picture detailed step-by-step guides. Find your perfect repair kit by heading to ifixit.com/LTT. If you guys enjoyed this video and you're looking for the polar opposite of an easy small form factor build, maybe check out, you could check out Andy's Intel Extreme Tech Upgrade. That was something else. Or you can check out that crazy water-cooled build that Jake did like 1,000 years ago. That was a sick build.
I know that one. It had a Titan RTX.